Week one of President Trump's administration, how decisions about the EPA, trade, and immigration impact Michigan. Plus, dozens of Michigan schools on the closure list and taking a look at our regional economy. Stay put. My week starts right now.
Did you know Gordon Food Service was started by a 23-year-old entrepreneur as a butter and egg delivery business more than a century ago? In 1948, school teacher Gerard Wendell Hayworth borrowed $10,000 from his parents to start a woodworking operation in his family's garage. It's now Hayworth Incorporated. These are just some of the ways Michigan's pioneers started out as small companies with big ideas.
We are business leaders for Michigan. We are committed to making Michigan a top 10 state for jobs, personal income, and a healthy economy. Funding is also provided by Delta.
Hi there, and welcome to My Week. I'm Christy McDonald. Thanks so much for joining us. It has been a week of keeping up with headlines, changes, and executive orders coming from the White House and President Trump. Many of the major initiatives he is tackling the first week on the job impact Michigan. So coming up on the show, we will look specifically at new immigration policies, concerns over program suspensions at the EPA, and what that may mean for Flint. Also, some infrastructure projects getting some D.C. attention, like the Sioux Locks, and what leaders of the big three automakers plan to do after meeting with the president this week. Also coming up for you, we'll look into the report from the State School Reform Office on schools that face shutdown and a progress check on our regional economy. It is all coming up for you on My Week. But let's start with President Trump's first week on the job and many of the big changes that affect us here. You know our contributors, Nolan Finley of the Detroit News, Stephen Henderson of the Detroit Free Press. Hey, guys, how are you?
I'm good.
You know, what's funny is I sat down and I was writing the intro of the show about, it's been a week basically of keeping up. I was also reading something, and it was an article in the Washington Post that said, feels like we've been drinking out of a fire hose this week, you know, in terms of all the headlines and all the various things that have happened. So before we dive into some of the specific changes, I think that especially here in Michigan that we're watching what President Trump is doing in D.C., I'm going to start with you, Stephen, first, and I want you to kind of give me what your overall impressions have been of the first week here of a Trump administration.
Well, it's definitely a thumbs down on substance.
All right, Siskel and Ebert.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's just not, I mean, I don't think there's any surprise there. I wasn't a fan of the things he said he was going to do during the campaign. I'm not a fan of the way they look once.
Are you surprised at the speed of some of the things that he had talked about?
No, I think that's. I actually think that's his style, is to come in and sort of blitz a lot of things and try to make an impression and keep his promises early. I guess if you are someone who thinks better of politicians who keep their promises, maybe you're inclined to think this is a good thing. He's doing it, and he's doing it quickly. But as policy matters, these are deeply problematic things. Some of them, I think, transgress pretty fundamental American principles. They take us back to times when not everybody was treated the same or looked at as the same here in this country. And I think that's really scary for people.
All right, Nolan, go ahead and give me what your impression is.
I think it was a schizophrenic week. I think there were some moments where I was saying, yeah, that's great, and others when I was, you know, what are you thinking?
What were the specific moments where you said, great, and then?
And I think the highlights of the week, particularly for Michigan, you had the automakers certainly were pleased with their conversations with him and felt buoyed and felt like we're going to see an economic surge in the country, and that's good. I was surprised that, you know, I would say the big winner of the week was labor. They walked in the Oval Office on the first day of a Republican presidency and walked out with most of their agenda. I mean, they got him to suspend the TPP, the Pacific Trade Agreement, and promised to reopen NAFTA. And not only that, they got him to twist the arms of corporate America to say, we want you to keep your jobs and factories here. What more could labor have asked for on day one?
And so let's go ahead.
That's more than they could have got from a
Democrat.
Let's go ahead and take a look at the significance of that, of having the big three sitting there at the White House on Tuesday of this first week.
No, I think that was important. I thought their response to it suggested that they got a lot of the things that they wanted to hear. I mean, the truth is that, you know, the auto industry has been doing quite well. In fact, set a record again last year with 17.5 million.
Yeah, the profit sharing checks. So they just announced on Thursday for Ford and Fiat Chrysler were good.
Yeah, so this is not an industry that needs Donald Trump to do one thing or another. The truth is that it's a cyclical industry. It still has some baked-in problems with the manufacture of small cars. Where is that going to happen? How can you do that at a profit? Donald Trump is not addressing those things. What he's saying is, I'll get the economy going so people buy more cars. But they're already at 17.5 million units, and nobody expects it.
Well, the companies have to make the shareholders happy here, Nolan.
Well, yeah, but he actually, you know, the things he's talking about is aimed at making production of small cars more profitable. If you reduce the regulatory and tax burden, then perhaps you can build small cars.
Maybe.
Right now, it doesn't make sense. But where they need his help most is they're heading towards 2025, and some really harsh environmental and mileage regulations kicked in. They were promised a midterm review in 2018. Obama killed that on his way out the door. They cannot continue this profit string and this sales string if they hit 2025 and they're forced to make a fleet of cars nobody's buying right now.
Well,
so they're talking about renegotiating NAFTA, but there's been some concerns that that's going to do some more damage to our economy than it's going to do.
Yeah, maybe, but hold on a second. The industry is not complaining about gas mileage, and nor are consumers. I mean, people are buying cars that get better and better gas mileage, and the industry is going along, and the industry believes, if you talk to them internally, the engineers know that the fuel-based car is sort of on its last leg, that's the thing that's holding everything back from development in the industry. So that's just, not true.
That's just wrong, Steve. I cover the auto industry. We wrote that during the auto show, and I wrote it. There's no way with the current fleet makeup that they can hit those numbers by 2025.
Right. And the market
for those hybrid and electric cars is not there. It's under 3% of the market.
It's developing.
And it has not developed. It's gone down
over the last
few years. People aren't buying those cars, and they won't buy those
from
cars
an engineering,
as long as gas
you're not hearing
prices
what I said. From an engineering perspective, anyone in the auto industry will tell you that the combustion engine is what is holding them back from the development that they all know is coming. And so the trick is to figure out how to make an alternative fuel source work. And consumers,
but they're not going to be there by 2025, and they
maybe
have no confidence.
I don't know.
They can't.
But there's no reason.
The mandates are well ahead of both technology and of market demand. People are not buying these cars.
All right, so let's talk a little bit about and bringing that back towards when they were talking to the automakers about building the plants here in Michigan and maybe easing off some of the regulations in terms of environmental regulations as well. And that gets us to kind of talking about what's happening at the EPA in freezing reports that are coming out and also freezing press releases as well out to the public. Everything has to go through political appointees before the information is coming out. How concerning is that for people, Nolan? And especially as we do connect that to if you start freezing programs as well, what does that mean for some of the help for
That's two different issues. I think the freezing of information is absolutely inappropriate, and I think that was lifted today or late yesterday. But the EPA is clearly in a target, and not a bad target. It has been a rogue agency. It has been an agency that has operated, I think, extra-constitutionally over these last several
years. How so?
Well, implementing sweeping changes to our economy and way of life while not going through our elected representatives. We're not a country that should be putting in place major policies through the rulemaking process. We have a lawmaking process to do that, and we bypass this, and I think you're going to come back to some balance here with the EPA.
The courts have actually said the opposite about that.
Sometimes not.
Republicans have been pushing that line for a long time, that the EPA is out of line. Most of the things that have been done over the last 8 years have passed court muster. They are not extra constitutional. Now, whether they're good or bad policy is another subject. And, you know, I mean, I think it's really important to put this in the context of the things that are going on in this country. The pollution that we deal with, the pollution of the water supply in Flint, all of these things have to do with regulation. Now, you can argue that regulation is too heavy and that somehow business is suffering as a consequence, but you can also argue that the lack of enforcement of regulation is what's causing things like Flint, is what's causing things like sinkholes in Macomb County that swallow up people's houses. So you've got to have a balance. I mean, you've always had to have some balance between allowing business to do the things that it needs to do to make money and protecting people from the dangers.
So what about that? What about that argument, Nolan, that you know that the EPA should have been more invested in what was happening in Flint, and it was perhaps the fact that they didn't step in enough or regulate enough that
Flint was incompetence. It wasn't an absence of a regulatory regime. You've got plenty of regulators there. What you had was incompetent bureaucrats caused the Flint problem. I don't know how you guard against incompetence through the regulatory process, and the EPA has been repeatedly rebuffed by the courts, most recently the Clean Power Plan, which was ruled unconstitutional or outside the law. Congress has a law in place that says if a rule has a certain amount of economic impact, it's got to be approved by Congress, and we have repeatedly ignored that at the EPA and putting in place these rules. It's got to be brought under control.
But again, tell that to someone in Flint.
How would
you sit across from someone who's drinking poison water and tell them, hey, you know
you
what,
had,
the EPA is out of control?
You could have had a whole nother 70,000 pages of regulations for Flint, and it wouldn't have prevented an incompetent bureaucrat from making a poor decision.
Let's be clear about incompetent bureaucrats. It was an emergency manager who reports to the governor who made these decisions and should have been stopped by the EPA.
He's a bureaucrat,
right?
And so were the people who decided.
So were the people. He's not a bureaucrat.
Were the people who said we're not going to put this water treatment, this corrosive treatment in the pipes.
I think when it got to the point, that the DEQ recognized that, and the EPA knew about it, and then took months to decide exactly how they were going to tackle
the corruption and incompetence at work, and no amount of regulation.
The idea that regulation is out of control will be hard to sell to people who are suffering because of environmental violations by industry and government.
Tell them how much more regulation would have prevented that.
All right, let's talk about, let's move on to something else, immigration. And also the fact that President Trump said, yes, we're going to start building the wall, we're going to start building it now, and taxpayers will be paying for it. We're going to get something back from Mexico eventually. And so when you look at the cost that the people are talking about, that could be somewhere $12 billion. How difficult, Nolan, is that to kind of sell to the public? Though his supporters, yes, that was one of the things that they really liked hearing from Donald Trump was, yes, he was going to build this wall. Is that the most effective use of $12 billion taxpayer money in terms of other spending when other people say, gosh, maybe we could spend a couple billion someplace else?
Of course not. And I think, you know, moving on this without fully studying whether it's going to be effective or not is one of the flaws you're going to see from this administration. He just plunges headlong, you know, into fulfilling these campaign promises. He could have satisfied his supporters with a more effective, by studying this and coming up with a more effective plan to secure the borders. People want the borders secure. Every other, you know, the United States has the same right of every other nation to maintain its borders and control its borders. But there are other ways to do it, I believe, that would be a lot cheaper and a lot more effective. We've had fences, we've had walls, and people still get past them. People are not going to be stopped by, how big is this wall?
Long as 20 feet or something.
No, it's not the full border. It's
it can't be.
You know, it can't be. So they're going to find ways around. You've got to get a comprehensive immigration policy in place. And we've been unable to do that for the past decade, 15 years. And so neglect of that kind invites extreme response. That's the risk you run.
Okay, so it's a multi-pronged approach. And he has said that as well. From some of the things that you're starting to hear about his immigration policies or his ideas, what are you thinking?
Well, I mean, so this is all symbolism, right? He knows that a wall won't work. He knows also that the Mexican government will not pay for the wall. But he's using this as a way to stoke fears about people from other countries coming here and sort of cutting in line in front of either legal immigrants or other American citizens. And this is about jingoism and nativism as much as it is about trade or immigration. It is about telling people that somebody else is coming here and taking from you the things that you need or the promise that that you think you're entitled to, and it's scapegoating. And so there are a lot of people, his supporters in particular, who are whooping about this because this is a response to their nativist fears. And there's something quite shameful about that, of course, as a, from a moral standpoint. The policy implications also are awful. This also gets to the, you know, the big fear of the Republican support for Trump, which is that one of the, he'll do something that starts a trade war. Starting a trade war with Mexico, which this could help incite, would damage everybody's economic fortune.
Or with any country. Trade wars are wrong. But I think it goes beyond the things you cited. We've sat here for 10, 20 years, 25 years without an immigration policy and allowed 12 million people to come into this country illegally. That rubs people the wrong way for a lot of reasons, primarily because they have a respect for the law. And, you know, people in this country have always supported legal immigration, and we need legal immigrants. We need a lot more immigrants from a lot more places bringing skills and the desire to contribute to society and work hard. We need a lot fewer illegal immigrants, and I think we've got to try to find a balance.
So what do you do? A wall doesn't deal with the people who are here. You can't send 12 million people home without spending more than $12 billion.
But you can't let another 12 million in.
But there aren't another 12 million coming.
We don't know.
Well, we do know. We don't know that border crossings are down, and they have been going down steadily for a long time.
But we can sit here and depend on the fact, well, maybe people won't want to come. Well, we've got to enforce our borders. We've got to deal with the 12 million here. I think it's not inappropriate to say we got to find a way to normalize them.
All right.
But I don't think it's inappropriate to say the ones who have here and abused our hospitality by committing crimes, you're going back. That's just common sense.
And we are going to have to see how all these details shake out in week two. Stay tuned, right? So just days after Governor Snyder said the state needed to address success in education, the state school reform office released a list of 38 schools that could be shut down because of constantly poor achievement. That number includes 16 schools in Detroit, plus 8 that are part of the EAA. Also some schools in Pontiac, Saginaw, Benton Harbor, Kalamazoo. Now we'll know in a few months if indeed the schools will shut down, but some could stay open if there isn't a better option nearby. But that doesn't rule out any other type of intervention. This list was based on the last 2 years of new state testing, in addition to the old MEAP test. Of a couple problems that I kind of have seen with this over the last week was that the governor addressed this in the State of the State address last week. He talked about education but said nothing about the school reform office. And then Friday, an hour before a new president was going to be inaugurated, this press release came out saying, these are the schools on the list. And it kind of got buried a little bit. But this is something that we've been talking about enforcement of, all right, now that these schools haven't been doing well, they need to be shut down or something needs to be changed. But the dot, dot, dot is, how does that actually work?
Right.
And what does that mean for the children who are there, and what makes that school shut down, what makes that a better option than what's going on in there? I'm going to give you first crack at this.
Well, that's a challenge for the new school board that just took place,
But we're not just talking Detroit, though. We are talking all over the state.
And particularly Detroit. I mean, we have roughly 40 to 50% more seats, classroom seats in Detroit than we have students. It's essential to shut down schools if they're going to be able to continue to operate debt-free and on a sound financial footing. They can't support that many extra seats, but they have to have an education structure, a system that makes sense geographically and for where people live. And it's tougher in Detroit because we have so many pockets, so many places that are sparsely populated and the good schools aren't necessarily there. This is going to be a real challenge for the new school board to take on, but ultimately it's the right thing to do. You want to get rid, when you have too many schools, you want to get rid of the bad ones.
So this is the first time that we're really seeing the state school reform board flex their muscle in this way, but there's not even really total agreement at the state level, even from the legislature, whether they should have the power to be able to do this or if they're doing it the right way.
Right. Well, I mean, there's no obvious plan here to move these kids to a better space. We have a map in the paper today that shows where these schools are located and all the schools that are around them and ranks them according to how they do on the tests. And for most of these
schools, looking at the better options,
what are the better options? Charter, public, EAA, the better options for the most part don't exist. You are trading one bad school for another bad school. And in the ideal, you're talking about schools that still fail 75% of their kids. I mean, 25% to 50% is the highest range on that. And so what it really is a testament to is the mess that we've all made here in Detroit with public, with improvement districts like EAA, and with charter schools, is that we have not created the quality options that parents in the city need. So if you are stuck in a school that's not performing, what alternative do you have? And this is not new. I mean, as a parent who operates in that system, I'll tell you, there's not great quality choices all over the place. There are not sufficient choices in many places. And so this map and this effort by the State Reform Office really brings into focus the fact that we just are not providing what we need for people in the city. So closing those schools is not a solution of any kind. It doesn't solve any of the problems that we have.
So you talk about the next steps in Detroit, Nolan, and you know, the interim superintendent, Alicia Merriweather, has been talking about, look, we've got to get together some kind of comprehensive plan to address that. And I think that they have so far in the beginning of the year. She's had at least a plan, and they're working with the EAA because some of those schools are coming back into the Detroit district. But what kind of guidance should they be looking for in terms of, okay, gosh, if you have, and you're talking about even other schools nearby, aren't the greatest alternatives?
Well, you know, it took a while, and they went through some really hard ups and downs, but the EAA schools are starting to post some really impressive results, or much better results.
Growth.
So maybe there's
growth.
A model.
It's growth.
So maybe, no, they're not anywhere near where they should be, but they're headed in the right direction. So maybe that's a model they can use. I think the overcapacity provides an opportunity to reconstitute schools with the best staffs. But you know, this is going to be,
you know, we also got to change the
horrible challenge.
We have to change the language that we use, right? Closing schools. There's no other state that you could go to where they talk about school improvement and use the word closing. There are lots of different ways to improve outcomes in schools, and closing a school is almost never on the list. That's only here in Michigan. Why is that true? Why are we doing something that states that are much more successful than us would never do?
Part of that is our population loss. I mean, we have more schools than we need. More.
Well, we've closed a lot of schools.
We've
closed 200 schools in the city of Detroit.
And we've lost a lot of students.
It's not a question. The geographic question is separate. This is closing because of performance, which doesn't happen in high-performing states.
But we're not a high-performing state.
Well, but maybe that's why.
One of the things here that's unique in Detroit, too, is some of our best schools in the city have empty seats. And you don't see that in other places either.
Well, you know, education obviously a concern in the region, I would say. But, you know, slow and steady, that seems to be the assessment of our local economy by the Detroit Regional Chamber. This week they released numbers that show personal income is on the rise. The region is more attractive to entrepreneurs and the capital that comes with them. Home values are up, but they're still not back to 2009 levels. And we're not growing population. And, of course, also they cited that education is a concern. Nolan, this week, when the chamber kind of released this and kind of ranked it out. Right. I mean, I think if you look back to the bankruptcy days and we were talking and saying, gosh, what is Detroit's future going to be? You would definitely say the growth that we've had here so far has been very, very good. But the challenges do remain when you say things are up, but they're not back to certain levels.
Well, we're climbing up from a very, very low point. And, you know, people should remember that. We are posting very good growth in this state and in this region, but we started from a dismal level. I think the most important stat that in that chamber report is the household income, the personal income report. That has been stagnant in the state for a long time. Meanwhile, cost of insurance and everything else has been going up, and families have been really struggling. I think if we can keep those personal income numbers moving, we create sort of a basis for a sustained recovery.
What did you see in this that stood out to you?
Yeah, I mean, I think, again, we are not focusing on the things that typically attract people to want to live in a certain place. I mean, we are. If you compare us, for instance, to Minneapolis, which is another Midwest city that's in a state that's had a much stronger recovery, if you look at the things that they're investing in those places, education, infrastructure, this idea of maybe raising taxes to pay for those things as opposed to cutting them, we're sort of headed in a really, really different direction. And, you know, it is slow and steady, recovery, but it could be faster, I think, if we did things different.
No, because we want to look at that population growth. We want to get more people here in the state of Michigan.
That's the challenge.
That's the tough part.
If you were making a choice about...
We have a lot of empty spaces to fill, you know, from what we lost, about a million people, or...
If you were looking at some place to live, and you looked at Detroit and compared it to Cincinnati, or Minneapolis, or Chicago, or Milwaukee, or even St. Louis, mm-hmm. there are a lot of things that you find in those other places that you do not find here.
All right. Well, we're going to have to leave it there. Thanks, guys. It's always good to see you. We'll see you back here next week.
Next
you promise?
Week.
Maybe.
What is next week?
What is next week? It's the beginning of February. It's exciting. All right. That is going to do it for My Week. Thanks so much for joining us. Check us out, myweek.org, or you can always follow us on social media, Twitter and Facebook. I'm Christy McDonald. We'll see you next time. Take care.
Take a look what's happening in Nashville.
Yeah.
Did you know? Gordon Food Service was started by a 23-year-old entrepreneur as a butter and egg delivery business more than a century ago. In 1948, school teacher Gerard Wendell Hayworth borrowed $10,000 from his parents to start a woodworking operation in his family's garage. It's now Hayworth Incorporated. These are just some of the ways Michigan's pioneers started out as small companies with big ideas.
We are business leaders for Michigan. We are committed to making Michigan a top 10 state for jobs, personal income, and a healthy economy. Funding is also provided by Delta.